Morning and welcome to our worship service today on the second Sunday of Advent. We light the second Advent candle, which is also one of the blue ones. It's the Bethlehem candle. It reminds us of the humble way the Savior was born, born in Bethlehem. Even though that does not look like a good place for a king to be born, yet this is our Savior's birthplace according to the promise. And we begin by singing the first hymn, which introduces us to John the Baptist. And we hear about him today, how he came to prepare us for the Savior. Today we will follow the order of the morning prayer. It's on page 207 if you're following in the hymnal. O Lord, open my lips. Hasten to save me, O God. Rejoice, your King comes to you.
Thank you.
Our psalm today is Psalm 130. We will hear the refrain, sing the refrain, and read the psalm responsively. My voice.
Listen closely as I call on you for help.
Lord, if you kept track of sins,
O Lord, then who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness. More than watchers wait for the morning.
My soul waits for the Lord.
Israel, put your hope in the Lord.
For the Lord is faithful love.
With him is complete redemption.
He will redeem Israel from the guilt of all their sins.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Old Testament lesson today for the second Sunday in Advent is taken from Isaiah chapter 11, beginning with the first verse. And we continue with this theme of illustrations of Emmanuel. You look at the graphic there in the bulletin. And today we're going to look at the stump, which is the middle one on the right-hand side. Isaiah talks about this stump and shows how the shoot comes up from the stump, which is the Savior, and the whole kingdom of the Savior then comes from this stump. And even pictures, looks ahead to the New Testament and to heaven when everything will just be perfect through our Savior Jesus. A shoot will spring up from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. He will be delighted with the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, nor will he render decisions based on what he hears with his ears, but with righteousness he will judge the poor. And he will render fair decisions in favor of the oppressed on the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he will put the wicked to death. Righteousness will be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his hips. The wolf will dwell with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the young goat, the calf, the young lion, and the fattened calf together, and the little child will lead them. The cow and the bear will graze together, and their young ones will lie down together. The lion will eat straw like the cattle. The nursing child will play near a cobra's hole, and a weaned child will put his hand into a viper's den. They will not hurt or destroy anywhere on my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. This is what will take place on that day. Peoples will seek the root of Jesse, will be standing like a banner for the peoples, and his resting place will be glorious. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our scripture reading this morning is written in Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 15. And in this lesson, Paul talks about how people from all nations will be a part of the New Testament kingdom. And so this is, again, this shoot that grows up and is the kingdom of the Lord, and we as Gentiles then have a wonderful place in the kingdom of God. Indeed, whatever was written in the past was written for our instruction, so that through patient endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we would have hope. And may God, the source of patient endurance and encouragement, grant that you agree with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that with one mind, in one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. For this reason, accept one another as Christ also accepted you to the glory of God. For I am saying that Christ became a servant of those who were circumcised for the sake of God's truth, to confirm the promises made to the patriarchs. He also did this so that the Gentiles would glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, "For this reason I will praise you among the Gentiles, and I will sing to your name." And again it says, "Rejoice, you Gentiles, with his people." And again, "Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples give him praise." And again, Isaiah says, "There will be a root of Jesse, and he is the one who will rise up to rule the Gentiles. On him the Gentiles will place their hope." Now may the God of hope fill you completely with joy and peace as you continue to believe, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's rise for our gospel lesson. Holy Gospel this morning is written in the third chapter of St. Matthew's Gospel. This lesson introduces us to the ministry of John the Baptist. So if you were going to send someone to prepare the way for a great king, he might be wearing fine clothes and riding in a chariot, right, or a fancy carriage to prepare the way for a king, but not John the Baptist. We see the humble way that he came because he's preparing the way for a humble Savior. In those days, John the Baptist appeared, preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is near." Yes, this is he of whom this was spoken through the prophet Isaiah, "A voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." John wore clothing made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. Then Jerusalem, all of Judea, and all the region around the Jordan were going out to him. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River as they confessed their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming for his baptism, he said to them, "You offspring of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Therefore produce fruit in keeping with repentance. Do not think of saying to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that God is able to raise up children for Abraham from these stones. Already the axe is ready to strike the root of the trees. So every tree that does not produce good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but the one who comes after me is mightier than I. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing shovel is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor. He will gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May be seated. We'll have our children's sermon. Just can come forward. Today I brought two branches from two Christmas trees. Do they look the same to you, or do they look different? Different, Asher says. One doesn't have as much as one. This is fake. Real, huh? Fake real. So very good. This comes from a fake tree. This comes from a real tree. We also call this artificial tree, right? And some of you, maybe in your home, you have a fake Christmas tree, an artificial Christmas tree, because they can be easier. Okay, so you don't get a lot of needles falling off on the rug, anything like that. Some people like a real tree, even though they can be messier, because they smell. You smell that evergreen. So, artificial, real. We can have an artificial Christmas and a real Christmas. So what do we mean by an artificial Christmas? That's just like all this fun stuff we do at Christmas. We can have parties, we can bake, we can have decorations, we can open presents. All that stuff is fun stuff, and it's all good stuff for us to do at Christmas. But what is the real reason for Christmas? Yes. Yes, Jesus our Savior is born. So it's good for us to remember that. Jesus was born and then grew up and died on the cross for our sins so that we can be in heaven with him. So that's the real meaning. All this other stuff is great fun, and we love that. But we also love that Jesus gave himself for us and was born to be our Savior. So let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we pray that you bless us with many enjoyable things during this holiday season, during this Christmas season. And thank you for family and friends and all those joys. But help us always to look to you and to remember that the reason we celebrate is because you came to be our Savior, and help us to find our true joy in you. We pray this in your name. Amen. Okay, we can go back and sit down, and we'll continue with our next hymn.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and our Savior Jesus. Amen. Word of God that we look at today, first of all, first two verses of our Old Testament lesson from Isaiah 11. A shoot will spring up from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And then also, Micah chapter 5, beginning with verse 2. But you, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, from you will go out one who will be the ruler for me in Israel. His goings forth are from the beginning, from the days of eternity. Therefore the Lord will give them up until the time when the woman who is in labor bears a child. Then the remaining survivors from his brothers will return to the people of Israel. He will stand and shepherd with the strength of the Lord and the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. They will dwell securely, for at that time he will be great to the ends of the earth. This is the word of God. May you see. Dear friends in Christ, let's say that you're in a strange city, now you're staying overnight there, you're in your hotel, you go online, you want to find a restaurant, a nice restaurant to have supper. And so you find one, and then you're following the directions to get to this restaurant, and as you're doing so, it is taking you into the part of the city that you don't know, that is getting darker and dirtier and more deserted as you go along. And so you say to the other person in the vehicle, this does not look right. Why would anyone put a restaurant here? Who would come to this part of town to eat in a restaurant? This just does not look right. Or let's say you get something in the mail from your doctor's office and you open it up and it's a bill for $549. And you look at that and you go, this is not right. This can't be right. We just got the EOB from the insurance company last week. It said they were going to pay the $549. This just does not look right. We're going to have to call them in the morning and get this all straightened up because this is not right. Sometimes maybe something like that happens in our lives. We look at something and it's like, this is wrong. This can't be right. Today, the Lord takes us through the prophet Isaiah to look at a stump. A stump which was once a great and beautiful tree, and from that stump is supposed to come the Savior. And we look at that and we go, this can't be right. How's the Savior going to come from here? That stump of Jesse was the father of David. The stump of David then takes us to the city of David, to Bethlehem, to this little tiny town, this little hick town, and the king of the world is going to be coming from that little town. We think about that and we go, well, that can't be right. How can the king and savior of the world come from Bethlehem? As we look at God's word today, we see that he has some surprises for us. And so our theme for today, this just does not look right when we look at this stump, and this just does not look right when we look at this little baby lying in a manger in the town of Bethlehem. So the stump that Isaiah talks about in verse 1 of chapter 11 was once a great, huge tree. He's talking about the nation of Israel, specifically the southern kingdom of the Judah, the Jews, and that was, well, before the split, it was a great kingdom during the time of David because God had given David victory after victory after victory, and the borders got bigger and bigger and bigger, and because of how huge the kingdom got, that meant all kinds of money and wealth and riches are coming into the kingdom to David and to Solomon. It says at the time of Solomon, there was so much gold and so much silver coming in that silver was pretty much worthless. And so this is a huge kingdom. But Isaiah says, this now is a stump. He says, that's what's going to happen. And that is what did happen in the southern kingdom of Judah. They had, from time to time, a good king who would take the people back to the true God. But for the most part, the other kings, the majority of the kings, led the people farther and farther away from God. And so after 350 years of this, God says, cup of my wrath is full. And God sent an axe to cut down that kingdom and take those people into captivity in Babylon. And so nobody reigning on the throne of David anymore. The kingdom of Judah is gone, taken away, and we look at that stump. And we go, how can this be? Hadn't God said that someone would reign on David's throne forever? Hadn't God said that the Savior of the world, Messiah, was going to come from the family of David? How can the Savior be coming when there is no family of David anymore? There is no throne of David. How can this be? This doesn't look right. And how can God be faithful to his promises, which he gave to David and to all of us, if it's just a stump now? This just does not look right. Well, we go to Isaiah chapter 11. A shoot will spring up from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit. Maybe you've had this happen where you cut down a tree, you don't want it there anymore, and so there's that dead stump there, and then a little bit later, this little green shoot starts growing up out of the side of the stump, growing up, and if you would leave that grow, then there would be a whole other tree growing up from that stump where that old tree was. And so that's what Isaiah is saying here is going to happen. And what God did make happen, because after 70 years of captivity, then he brought his people back to Jerusalem, and they rebuilt the city, and they rebuilt the walls, and they rebuilt the temple, and established all this again, and there was someone reigning on David's throne. But then, for 400 years, nothing. Just radio silence, just quiet. And then all of a sudden, randomly, it seems, the angel Gabriel comes to a priest named Zacharias as he's serving in the temple and says, your wife is going to have a child. This wife, Elizabeth, who was way past the time of having a child, he says, she's going to have a child. And he will be the forerunner for the Savior. And then 6 months later, this same angel goes to a young woman in Nazareth, a virgin, and says, you're going to have a child, and he's going to reign on the throne of his father David forever. And she says, how can this be? I'm a virgin. This is impossible. And yet, this is the shoot that grows up and comes to the place where we find this little baby lying in a manger. God works his miracles when it looks like it just can't happen. Do you have any stumps in your life? You made plans to do this or that, plans to have this happen, and then it just seems like your plans get cut up from under you, and it doesn't happen. Do you have hopes or dreams? I'd like for this to happen or that to happen, and then it just gets cut off at the bottom, and your hopes are gone. Or you look at your life, and it seems like nothing seems to be going right. Whatever you touch just turns wrong, and then you say, I'm just a big failure, and how can this be? It just doesn't look right. And yet, God shows us here with the shoot coming up from the stump that God can work amazing things out of little tiny things, and God can make amazing things happen with his power. Now, I'm not saying that God is going to undo every bad thing that happens to us, but when it looks like our plans have failed, God says he has plans for us. And they are plans to give us hope in a future. When it looks like disaster and there's no way that anything good can come out of this, God says, I make everything work out for good in your life. And when we look at our life and it seems like such a mess, God says, I forgive you. You are my own precious child. You are dear to me because I sent my only son to die for you. And so God can make amazing things come out of what looks like it's just not going to happen. And that's what we see when we look at this stump, which was once the kingdom of Israel. And as we said now, this stump takes us to David and takes us to Bethlehem. And we look at that town of Bethlehem, and again we think, well, this can't look right. How would the Savior come from here? Let's say that you and your spouse are planning to have a baby. And so, what are your plans? How are you going to work this out? Where are you going to have the baby? Some people decide to have their baby's at home. They hire a midwife, the midwife comes, the baby is delivered at home because it's comfortable, you're in your home. But most people go to a hospital. Why? Because, well, at the hospital, there's all kinds of medical personnel. There's doctors and nurses and pediatricians, so there's all kinds of people there. There's all kinds of equipment, medical equipment and operating rooms. If something goes wrong, all that's available to you so you can have a safe baby. In fact, you might even tour this hospital and that hospital and the birthing center at this hospital to pick out just the one that seems right for you and for your baby. Would you plan to have your child in a stinky, dirty barn? No way, right? Nobody plans that. Put yourselves in the sandals of Joseph. And an angel comes to you in a dream and says your fiancé is going to give birth and he is the Son of God, Savior of the world. Or if you're a lady, put yourself in Mary's sandals and an angel comes to you and says you're going to give birth and he's going to be the Son of God. So how do you plan for this birth? The birth of the Son of God. You don't want to mess this up, right? Because you don't want something to go wrong with the Son of God. And so, well, they didn't have a lot of fancy hospitals then with a lot of expensive medical equipment. So maybe you plan to have this birth at home with people who have done this before, know what they're doing, so they could be there to support you. Would you plan to take a trip to Bethlehem while your future wife is so far along in her pregnancy? 90 miles, 30 hours. Would you do that? No way you wouldn't plan that, but that's what had to happen, right? Because you had to go to Bethlehem to register for the census. And where are you going to find a place to stay when you get to Bethlehem? Because it's full of people. Do you think Mary and Joseph were totally freaking out? Where are we going to have this baby? How are we going to do this? This is the Son of God is going to be born. And would you plan to have the birth of the Son of God in a dirty, stinky barn? No, you wouldn't, right? Okay, so God now is planning to send his only Son to earth to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Where would he plan to send his son to be born? We might think, well, in Jerusalem. That's the capital city, in the palace in Jerusalem. And remember when the wise men came and they said, where is he who has been born King of the Jews? Where did they go? They went to Jerusalem. They went to the palace. This makes the most sense. But that wasn't the plan, was it? The scribe said, well, you got to go to Bethlehem. That's what it says in Micah. To that little hick town of Bethlehem. And if you're God, would you plan to have your son to be born in a dirty, stinky barn? No. I wouldn't, right? If I'm God, I wouldn't plan that. But that's how God planned it out, and that's how he worked it out. It doesn't look right to us, but this is God's plan because he had his son born in this humble way because his son came in humility to be a human being and to die on the cross for our sins. He had his son born in this humble way so that we would know it's not what we do. It doesn't depend on us. It's all on Jesus and the humble way that he came to be our Savior. And so God's plan shows us this little baby lying in a manger born in Bethlehem. You know, and again, we look at our life and we go, well, this doesn't look right at all. Because I'm a sinner. I'm a horrible, miserable sinner, and there's no way I can be right with God. There's no way I can stand in his presence. This can't be right. How can that happen? But God made it possible by sending Jesus. God worked it out. God sent his Son, the true Son of God, to become a human being, take on flesh and blood so that he could be God and man in one, so he could live perfectly for us, so he could die on the cross for us, and so that death could count for the sins of the world. God sent his Son, born of a woman, so he could die, but so then he could rise again by his almighty power, so that we could have the promise of the resurrection and eternal life in heaven. This is God's plan, which we think, how is this going to work out? But he worked it out perfectly so we can be saved. Not of our doing, nothing that we can do. All done by Jesus. And is God still doing miracles in our lives today? Think of how we were born. Sinful, enemies of God, blind. We cannot, by our own thinking or choosing, believe in Jesus Christ our Lord or come to him. That's what we memorized in confirmation class. But God sent us his Holy Spirit. And by the miracle of baptism, the waters of baptism, God brought us as little infants to faith. What a miracle that is. And God continues to work in us through the miracle of his word. Through the miracle of his word, he gives us peace that surpasses all understanding. We look at that peace, the world looks at that peace, and they go, how can Christians have peace? But we have peace in Jesus. He gives us the comfort of his love. And he gives us the joy of knowing that we will be in glory one day. Those are miracles that come from the almighty power of God's word and the power of the sacrament, the power of the bread and wine, becoming the very body and blood of Christ. What a miracle that is. And how that strengthens us in our faith. Jesus once talked about the little mustard seed and how that little mustard seed could grow up into a huge tree. And so we look at that little stump cut off and go, how can anything come from that? But from that, Jesus brought forth his, or God brought forth his son, who gave himself into death for us. And we look at that town of Bethlehem and we think, how can anything good come from this city? And yet, there we see the baby lying in a manger in Bethlehem. We pray that God would lead us and encourage us to trust in the power of his word for our life and salvation. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we continue by singing the song of praise.
Thank you.
seated. Offering will be brought forth.
Thank you.
Hear my voice when I call, O Lord. Be merciful and answer me. Almighty God, whose ears are always open to our prayers, hear now the prayers of your people. We thank you for your sure word of prophecy and its fulfillment in the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ. We glorify you, Lord, for bringing forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, the branch, Jesus Christ our Lord. We thank you, O Lord, for anointing him with your Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might. Stir up our hearts, O Lord, and fill us with all joy and peace in believing. May we abound in hope through the power of your Holy Spirit. Empower us to serve and love you with pure hearts and obey you with willing hands. As you have welcomed us into your fellowship in Christ, may we welcome many others. Give us one voice to glorify you as the God and Father of our Savior Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we include a prayer on behalf of Bob Miller, who's in the nursing home in Darlington, Dick Duclo, who is in Ripon, Shanley Mace, who did come home from the hospital. And also, we remember the family of Pastor Mike Zuberbier. Pastor Zuberbier is pastor at St. Peter's in Fond du Lac. Unexpectedly, I was taken into heaven yesterday, leaves behind a wife and three grown children. So we pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we pray for all of those who are ill, for Bob and for Chumley and for Duke. We pray, Lord, that you would use your almighty power, your healing power, to restore Chumley to health and make him well again. We pray that you would use your healing power to give Bob and Duke more time with their family and take away any pain. Above all, we pray that you would bless them with the almighty power of your word to give them comfort and knowing that you are with them. We pray also that you would be with Pastor Zuberbier's family. Give them the blessing of your comfort and your peace and the home, the promise of a blessed home with them in heaven. In our Savior's name we pray, and in his name we join in praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us praise the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
again, welcome. Glad to have you with us today, especially if you're visiting us. My apologies on that first hymn. I realized what I did. I didn't put the last verse on the PowerPoint. You know, just once, when something goes wrong, I wish it would be somebody else's fault and not my fault. It's just always my fault. So, sorry about that. But the choir, if there's choir people that want to stay in practice after church, we will do that. Going to our three people we prayed for. So Chumley, as mentioned, came home on Monday afternoon. Rose said his numbers are still high. His kidney and liver functions are really higher than they should be. He gets winded and dizzy if he tries to go out in the barn in the cold air. So he's not really a healthy man still. Has a touch of pneumonia in one of his lungs, but he is home. And so we're thankful for that and keep him in our prayers. So Bob Miller, about 2 weeks ago, really took a turn for the worse, but then just kind of seemed to turn around and bounce back. He went home with his family on Thanksgiving. Seems to be doing better. He still has this infection, so he's not going to ever be totally healthy, but is doing better for right now and remains on hospice. Duke Duclo, as we mentioned, had a stroke Sunday before last and is in Whispering Pines in Ripon and has been going down. So. Is not doing well. So we'll keep all these folks and their families in our prayers. Practice for Christmas Eve continues, 8:00 on Sunday morning. I think there's some spots left on the sign-up sheet if you would like to bring some snacks for that. We want to thank everyone who brought food or toys or pajamas. This is the last weekend that we'll be collecting for that, so thank you everyone for that. There is still a chance to put something on the Tree of Love if you would like to do that. We'd like to have that all wrapped up by the 18th, the Sunday before Christmas, so we can get that all typed up and printed up. If you're on the usher schedule and you like a different month, talk to Billy. He's working on that. He'll fix you up there. Also, online givers. This is something that if you give online and because of that you don't think you need a box of envelopes, let me know and we'll give you a box of envelopes. So, because envelopes will be coming out pretty soon. The sign-up sheets are still there for cleaning and altar duties. We had our council meeting this week. We have cleaners signed up through May, so we're going to, that's the plan, and hopefully more people will sign up as we go along. Also, the Ladies' Aid, this is new, the Ladies' Aid is asking for help from men for setting up tables and chairs for funerals, especially if it's a little bigger and we have to get tables out of those extra places and chairs off the rack. So there is a sign-up sheet if you would be willing to help with setting up and taking down for that. They're all different colors, so there's like four sign-up sheets there. Make sure you sign up on the right ones. Also, this note about the parking lot. When you look in the newsletter, it says 10,635. The bulletin says 10,235. We received the donation, so it is up to 10,635. Men of His Word Conference, so that's the last notice there. And there are handy-dandy little cards by the bulletins there. This is a conference for men, and there's a little bit describing it there. I have not been, but if you know Willis Kumro, he's been there a lot. You could talk to him. He says it's great. So if you're interested, there's a website there with more information. We're going to... if you could pull the plug on that laptop, we're going to look at the video. And I guess you got to be careful what you wish for. That was not my fault. So I wished for that, I guess. I'm kind of springing this on Pam, but our congregation, as part of the LWMS, has been assigned some missionaries. So if you would like to have some names and addresses of three or four missionaries, one is in Albania, they're in Russia, and the other two are in this country. She can hook you up with some addresses that you could send a note to or encouragement. Okay, birthday game or anniversary?
Ben Bruss.
Happy birthday, Ben. When's your birthday?
Yesterday.
Happy birthday.
We got some upstairs.
Okay. Okay, wow. All of them sound right days, huh? That's pretty cool. Happy birthday to all the offs up there. Yeah, it was the party at the Odd House. Now, it seems to me that there was a birthday somewhere in this area that didn't get mentioned, and a number of people last week said, oh, we need to mention that, maybe even put it in the bulletin. Yeah.
She left.
Yeah, she was going to say that she's
pretty. Sandy O'Dell. Something to do with it, I don't know.
Yeah, she said it was your birthday, like last week or?
2 weeks
ago. 20th, okay. And you neglected to bring it up, huh?
Yeah, you thought he'd get away with it since Pastor Meyer was here that day.
Okay. Somebody else besides Sandy mentioned it too.
Oh.
Happy birthday, Doug.
Thank you.
Okay, anyone else?
Sue,
your birthday?
No.
No?
I'm accusing her of maybe being one of them.
Oh.
School. No, but I knew it was
you. Okay.
Pastor, somebody up here knew it was November 20th, too.
Really?
Know why he knew.
Your sister?
Oh, my dad knew it was the 20th for some reason.
Okay. Happy birthday, Brian. I'm the 20th also, huh? All right. Share a birthday. 4 years younger.